Yesterday, I came across this article entitled, "No, I Won't Stop Saying White Supremacy." I thought that is a very weird photograph. The author of this piece was not immediately visible to me, and I also didn't pay attention to it until after I was a couple paragraphs down. When I started reading it, initially, I thought, okay, this isn't a bad article. Let's see what else the person has to say. And then everything just went downhill really quick. And that's what prompted me to want to make this video. Let's begin. She says, "I am white. When I give talks on what it means to be white in a society deeply separate and unequal by race, I explain that white people who are born and raised in the US grow up in a white supremacist culture. I include myself in this claim. So I enumerate all of the ways in which I was socialized to be complicit in racism. I am not talking about hate groups, of which I am obviously not a member. And no, I don't hate white people. I am addressing most of the audience to whom I am speaking, white progressives like me." Okay, I'm going to stop her for a second. So far, I don't hear anything that's incorrect. I would completely agree that our culture is white supremacist. This doesn't mean that every white person is a white supremacist, but it means we were all raised under white supremacist ideas. Okay? Let's continue. She says, "If it surprises and unsettles my audience that I use this term to refer to us and not them, even after I have explained how I am using it, then they have not been listening. That recognition should trigger some sense of urgency that continuing education is needed." Okay, I'm gonna stop her again. I still don't see a problem with anything she's written at this point. She continues writing, "Yet invariably, a white person raises the objective. I really don't like that term. I associate it with the KKK and other white nationalist groups. Why can't you use a different term? As a classic example of white fragility, rather than stretching into a new framework, I am asked by a white participant to use language that is more comfortable and maintains their current worldview. Many people, especially older white people, associate the term white supremacy with extreme and explicit hate groups. However, for sociologists, white supremacy is a highly descriptive term for the culture we live in, a culture which positions white people and all that is associated with them, whiteness, as ideal." She continues writing by saying, "White supremacy captures the all-encompassing centrality and assumed superiority of people defined and perceived as white, and the practices based upon that assumption. White supremacy is not simply the idea that whites are superior to people of color, although it certainly is that, but a deeper premise that supports this idea. The definition of whites as the norm or standard for human, and people of color as an inherent deviation from that norm. Thus, when race scholars use the term white supremacy, we do not use it in the same way as mainstream culture does. nor do we use it to indicate majority versus minority relations. Power is not dependent on numbers, but on position. We use the term to refer to a socio-political economic system of domination based on racial categories that benefit those defined and perceived as white. This system rests on the historical and current accumulation of structural power that privileges, centralizes, and elevates white people as a group. If, for example, we look at the racial breakdown of the people who control our institutions, we see that in 2016 to 2017, now I'm not going to read this part here, but you can look at it to see what she's doing. She's sharing about the president's cabinet, Congress, governors, military advisors, people who decide what news is covered, what books we read, teachers, the percentage of people who are white. And I'm looking at this, and this is where everything starts to go downhill, because for one thing, she makes the classic liberal mistake of thinking that skin color denotes ideology. Let me explain something really quick, please. This liberal belief is actually why white liberals and white progressives will start arguing with black or brown Republicans and trying to put them in their place and trying to get them to see that they're really systematically oppressed. And this is why you see white progressives telling black or brown people, you're a traitor to your own people. These white progressives are white supremacists. Because the way they talk to black and brown people shows they believe they have a position of superiority and a right to rule over them. It took me some time to realize the author of this article is Robin DiAngelo. Once I saw that, then the bizarre turn this article was taking started making a lot more sense. She is the person who wrote that book entitled White Fragility. I've never heard any of her views before, but I've always known she was a progressive. And the common theme with progressives who are white, liberals who are white, and Democrats who are white, is that not one of them can properly define racism or white supremacy. Now, the more we get into this article, I think you're going to see why. Robin DiAngelo begins making this argument here that supports DEI. See, because people think skin tone denotes ideology, whenever people hear me talking about these political issues and they see my skin tone, they think I'm a white progressive. I'm not. Never have been. Which is why I can see through this stuff. So let's continue. She writes, these numbers are not a matter of good people versus bad people. They are a matter of power, control, and dominance by a racial group with a particular self-image, worldview, and set of interests in the position to disseminate that image and worldview and protect those interests across the entire society. Is it just me, or was that like a paragraph that was filled with mostly a run-on sentence of word salad? Every single ethnic group, skin color, it's a part of nature for those people to work for their own interests. This is natural, you guys. Something else I spoke about in my video entitled Defining White Supremacy is that Black and brown people are also under this same system. To use Robin DiAngelo's terminology, which is the politically correct one that racist whites like to use, which is people of color, which is actually a very, very racist term. As some Black people have pointed out, it's just inverting that old racist term, colored people. And I've spoken about this before on Twitter, but I'm not on there anymore. Why is it that white people are just people? But when you're referencing Black or brown people, you have to say people of color. It's like you're hyphenating their humanity, that they're not just basic people like we are. Like, these politically correct people, they end up being even more racist than the white conservatives they're trying to counter or fight. Every person born in the United States is an American. But you'll notice the politically correct whites like to say things such as African American. Even though a lot of Black people, they're not from Africa. I've even seen white progressives try to be so progressive that they think Black people should go back to Africa. And they really want to see Africa do well, and they really want to see all the Black people go there. And they feel like they're being a really good ally, when actually that's so fucking racist. And you're also standing from your position of wanting to dictate what Black and brown people should do. And it's like these white people don't even see it. Robin continues. For a clear example of what it means to have institutional control and use it to the advantage of your group, we can look to women's suffrage in the U.S., Only white men could grant women suffrage because white men controlled the government and all of the other institutions that allowed them to disseminate and enforce patriarchy across society. They still do. While women could be prejudiced against men and discriminate against individual men in isolated cases, women as a group could not deny all men their civil rights. Yet men as a group could deny all women their civil rights. Once white men finally granted women the right to vote, only white men could deny access to that right for women and men of color. White people also write the history that tells us that women were granted the right to vote, and erases the reality that that access was not granted equally across race. The term white supremacy allows us to capture the all-encompassing and multidimensional nature of white control. Okay, so this woman is a See You Next Tuesday. How this woman wants to get people to understand white supremacy is she's talking about power, positions of power. So she wants to show everyone how white women were able to discriminate against white men, but couldn't actually take white men's rights away because white men held the power, okay? So this is also her analogy with the racial structure. So to use an example, let's say Black people can discriminate against white people or be prejudiced, but don't have the structural power to take white people's positions away or our rights. So Robin DiAngelo is trying to make a similar analogy that we can all relate to. And she has to bring up patriarchy. Okay. You'll never see me talking about feminism or patriarchy because patriarchy is not a problem. The way that masculinity is expressed through white America is where a lot of the problem comes from, but not masculinity in and of itself. Another reason women have been so mistreated in this country is because of the cultural influence from the Christian faith. It's a combination of both things. When progressives and liberals talk about toxic masculinity, they fall short of explaining it correctly because then they start talking about toxic masculinity also involves transphobia, homophobia. I'm like, oh my God, you guys, stop it. You're not making one bit of sense because progressives and liberals who are white, they cannot explain anything if their life depends on it because their ideology is just crap. It's like the type of rotten tomato splat where a person is trying to explain something and they're just failing on every account. And so people are throwing really ripe tomatoes at them just to make it stop. And if their mouths get filled with all of the slush from overly ripe red fruit, then maybe their mouth is too busy and they can't keep talking nonsense. Any type of so-called phobia that involves a religion or a sexual orientation or a gender, people need to just stop, because an actual phobia doesn't involve any of the characteristics that people are claiming, which is just certain people not agreeing with some religious ideologies, gender ideologies, or even sexual orientations. So back to the point here, patriarchy is not a problem. The way white masculinity is expressed in this country is a problem. And it does come from our European roots, our British roots. And I'm not going to get into that in this video. So everything Robin DiAngelo is trying to explain is just going splat all over the place. Because, yes, this country was originally made, set up, given rights for white men. This is just a fact. When we are talking about people who are out and proud with white supremacist ideology, they're the ones who will flat out tell you white people are superior. And if you don't believe that, you've been brainwashed by the Jews. That's your typical white supremacist, whether it's in Europe or here in the United States. Those people will gladly admit that they think white people are superior. Now here's the thing. If a white person, an individual like myself, who is from European descent, if such a person thinks, you know what, we are the best, we are the most superior, we are the most intelligent, we're the most beautiful, it's okay if people think that. That in and of itself is not white supremacy, you guys. And the reason is because every group of people in the earth, every racial group, every ethnic group, if they believe they are the best, that's okay. It's just like when you look at your child and you think your child is the most beautiful child who's ever existed. You think that because that's your baby. Or you look at your wife or your husband and you think that person is the most beautiful thing. It's because that's your bond. That's you. So you think that way. That's okay. So even Robin DiAngelo having this idea that, like, well, white people thinking that they're, like, superior. It's okay if people think that way. It's okay if brown people think they're superior. Do you see where I'm going with this? That in and of itself is not white supremacy or brown supremacy. I've even talked to black people before who think they are the best and that their melanin is a superpower and that they have better qualities than white people. It is okay if they think that way and have pride in who they are. Same thing with white people. That's not supremacy. Black people fighting for their own interests, whether they are in power or out of power, is not black supremacy. In the same way, white people fighting for their own interests, whether they are in power or out of power, is not white supremacy. Now that you've heard my views here, do you see how Robin DiAngelo really isn't explaining what white supremacy is? Instead, she's creating this weird outlook where if there are a lot of white people in a position of power, they're going to be working for their own interests. And therefore, this is supremacy. This is white supremacy. So she is setting things up so that the only way to reverse white supremacy is to discriminate against individuals of European descent and try to pass the torch to black or brown people to give them more opportunities because you see them as being inferior. Welcome to the world of Democrat politics. Okay, so now Robin DiAngelo is going to try and explain the fact that she's not making sense. She writes, "While the dominant racial ethnic group in other cultures may not be white, for example, the Chinese rule Tibetans, and the Tibetans may experience racism from the Chinese, there is nonetheless a global dimension of white supremacy." Okay, but hold on, let me just interrupt her. The way she has explained white supremacy so far hasn't been white supremacy. It's just been individuals of European descent working for their own interests, which is clearly what she's sharing the Chinese are also doing, and using racism at times to do it. Okay, let's see what she has to say. Robin writes, "Through mass media, corporate culture, advertising, United States-owned manufacturing, military presence, historical colonialist relations, missionary work, and other means, white supremacy is also circulated globally." Okay, but she still hasn't explained what it is. Whatever, let's continue. She writes, "One of the most potent ways this is disseminated is through media representations, which have a profound impact on how we see the world. Given the role of media in modern life, films shape our ideas about romance, conflict, family, friendship, sexuality, criminality, belonging, and otherness." Okay, one thing I wanted to say, I don't know if you guys noticed this, but when she was talking about the percentages of people who were in power in our country, it was like all white, 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 white. She didn't even mention the fact that ethnic Jews also hold a significant influence and power in Hollywood. Why is that? Why didn't she talk about that? Is Robin DiAngelo like some Black Americans are who think that any person who has lighter skin is European? Because they do. It's amazing the amount of Black people I've talked to who don't understand that Jews are not just a religious group, they're also an ethnic group. They have a completely different background than we do. Their ancestors are not our ancestors. It's very much like looking at Syria's president, Bashar al-Assad, who has a similar skin color that I do, but he's like Assyrian or something. He's not European. Black Americans have, a lot of them, have a similar limited view of the world that many white Americans do. Like when my son was younger, there were white kids who were calling my son Spanish, and they were doing that because my son has brown skin, but he's not Spanish. This happened even in the last couple of months where I was talking to a gentleman about my son, and he was trying to identify if he remembered meeting him, and he said, "Is he like Hispanic or Asian?" And I just said yes, because I knew that he was picturing my son, even though my son isn't either of those two things. This is what I see with Black Americans a lot too. A good many of them think whoever has lighter skin is white. Like, it's a limited American perspective. And so when you try and tell a lot of these Black Americans, hey, Jewish people aren't white, they're like, oh, you just don't want the association. No, they're literally not Europeans. They're not from our ethnic group. They don't even have the same facial structure as us. But you're not going to notice this because you probably think we all look the same. See? Okay. But this is my point about Robin DiAngelo. She put all of the influence on white people. So Robin continues. She says, those who write and direct films are our cultural narrators. The stories they tell shape our worldviews. Given that most white people live in racial isolation from people of color, and Black people in particular, and have very few authentic cross-racial relationships, white people are deeply influenced by the racial messages in films. Okay, see, I come from a big city, and when you live in a big city, it's racially diverse. It's like, yeah, so moving on. She continues by saying, of the 100 top grossing films worldwide in 2016, 95 were directed by white Americans, 99 of them by men. Oh, heaven forbid. Sorry. Okay, let's continue. Do you see how she is really like demonizing? Never mind. I'm not going to go into that right now. Okay. She continues, that is an incredibly homogenous group. Because these men are most likely at the top of the social hierarchy in terms of race, class, and gender, they are the least likely to have a variety of authentic, egalitarian cross-racial relationships. Yet they're in the position to represent the racial other. Their representation of the other are thereby extremely narrow and problematic and reinforced over and over. Okay, again, I just want to like cut her off for a minute. Let me go back to the Jewish thing. Yeah, I'm going to do it. One issue that really, really bothers me, and I would really like people to hear me on this, is the cultural influence on American males because of our so-called Judeo-Christian roots. Judeo-Christian values. Okay, you hear right-wingers talk about this a lot. Judeo-Christian values is not a thing. When you're a Christian, you have Christian values. Well, right-wingers say that because of the United States and Israel alliance. They also say it because political right-wingers, they use aspects of the Old Testament that enable them to be white nationalist, Christian nationalist, and warmongers, which is something they also have in common with the Democrats. Like, yeah, the whole system is white supremacy. The whole culture is white supremacy. So Robin, Miss DiAngelo, you being a progressive doesn't put you outside of a white supremacist system. You can put as many black and brown people in positions of power under the United States government, and it is still just as much a white supremacist system as it always was. This is the gotcha moment that progressives and black Democrats don't understand. The only difference is that liberals, progressives, leftists, Democrats are more open to having so-called people of color in positions of power. But the people behind the scenes, the ones who are really running the country, are never going to allow the country to completely abandon its foundations. And the sooner people realize that, the less they'll try to infiltrate it to change it. This is also what Islamist groups like the Muslim Brotherhood do. They try to get themselves in positions of government influence and media while pretending to be standing for democracy, patriotism, liberal values, but really underneath it all, they just want to put more and more political Islamists in power so they can eventually change the system to majority Muslim, to infiltrating governments through mass migration, and by changing policies in a way that it ends up being an Islamist takeover. The thing is, while that may work in places like England, it's never going to work in the United States for one fundamental reason. People here are armed. And if you think for a second you can just like install black and brown people, and I say install and I mean that in a demeaning way because that's what these white people are doing. They're treating black and brown people like objects that they're going to allow to be in positions of power. Let's just install these people. That'll make up for the racism. And they're never really dealing with the underlying issues that have made the country the way it is. This is all performative, and Robin DiAngelo is no different. She has it in her head that if white Americans are doing anything, I love how she says this about white men. She says, these, like, start reading right there, okay? Because these men are most likely at the top of the social hierarchy in terms of race, class, and gender. She's just decided, okay? What she's also leaving out is the fact that Jewish people are very, very powerful in Hollywood. And they even say this. It's not a conspiracy theory. This is just true. And this is what I want to say, getting back to what I said I wanted to talk about regarding the Jewish folks. Because of their religious customs, you had better believe this influences our country. The number one reason American male babies have their bodies altered shortly after birth is because of the Jewish influence in our country. Because that is part of their religious customs. European men look at our country and they just cannot relate to it. They don't understand why circumcision is so prevalent here in our country. I believe that babies didn't ask to be born. And because I believe that, I believe it should be their choice what they do with their body when they get older. I don't believe that parents should make that choice for babies because it's also a painful procedure. Jewish mothers have even come out and spoken about the fact that the reason circumcision is pushed so hard in our country is because of Jewish doctors. What I have noticed about Hollywood entertainment programs and movies is Jewish writers and Jewish directors for shows like Seinfeld and Sex and the City shaming and mocking men who are uncircumcised. That's what I have a problem with. I don't think you should be shaming or making fun of men, whatever their body is. My whole reasoning behind all of this is that they do it in a way to make men feel like something is wrong with them if they're not circumcised. So Robin DiAngelo's view is very strange to me, how she's completely leaving out the influence of Judaism and Jewish culture on our society, and how it has also played a major role and shaping the opinions that men have of themselves. I'm going to talk more about this definition in a moment for white supremacy, but yes, white supremacy is a real thing in our country. But Robin DiAngelo's article barely scratches the surface of it because she tries to run and dance around the bush. She's also neglecting the fact that, yes, even though white people are involved in Hollywood cinema and shaping public opinion, so are Jewish people. Their interests work with white interests. Yes, in Hollywood, the white man is the victor. The white man gets the girl. The white man saves the brown woman. We see these attitudes all over society. It's also a common trope that in horror movies, black people tend to die first and do the most stupid things, when in reality, it's reversed and it's usually white people who are ignoring their street smarts and walking into that dark alley to say, hello, who's there? Of course, these are just examples, but my point is, if the white man is the valiant one who saves the brown people, who fights the Middle Eastern savages, you know who else that benefits, don't you? Israel. So what is her motive behind all of this? Because to me, the impression I get from her is that she does hate individuals from our ethnic group who are so-called white. And people sometimes arrive at that conclusion about me when they don't understand the number one reason I can't stand the way a lot of white Americans act is because they don't unlearn this stuff. And she's one of them. Some of the worst people in our country are the anti-racist white people because they're the most racist. Robin continues, okay? She says, take for example, the Jackie Robinson story. Robinson is often celebrated as, quote, the first African American to break the color line and play in Major League Baseball, end quote. While Robinson was certainly an amazing ball player, this storyline depicts Robinson as racially special. A black man who broke that color line himself. The subtext is that Robinson finally had what it took to play with whites, as if no black athlete before him was strong enough to compete at that level. Imagine if, instead, the story went something like this. Quote, Jackie Robinson, the first black man whites allowed to play Major League Baseball. End quote. This is a critical distinction because no matter how fantastic a player Robinson was, he simply could not play in the major leagues if whites, who control the institution, did not allow it. Were he to walk onto the field before being granted permission by white owners and policymakers, the police would have removed him. Narratives of racial exceptionality obscure the reality of ongoing institutional white control while reinforcing the ideologies of individualism and meritocracy. They also do whites a disservice by obscuring the white allies behind the scenes who worked hard and long to open the field to African American players. These allies could serve as much needed role models for other whites, although we also need to acknowledge that in the case of the desegregation of baseball, there was an economic incentive for these allies. Do you see what, let me just stop her. Do you see what Robin DiAngelo is doing? She's only comfortable with a narrative if it shows that white people were the saviors. Like, I can't explain this in a way that's more clear. If there's any person listening to me who doesn't see this. She writes, white supremacy as a powerful ideology that promotes the idea of whiteness as the ideal for humanity is especially relevant in countries with a history of colonialism by Western nations. Like, I just have to interrupt here. It's getting hard for me to continue because she's still not done. Like, there's just, it's like the Energizer Bunny. It just keeps going and going. And the problem is, up to this point, she hasn't even shared anything that simply defines white supremacy. Instead, it's like just all this runaround stuff. All right, in order for me to explain my next point in a succinct way, I'm going to cut through all of Robin DiAngelo's bullshit, including the stuff you haven't even heard her say yet. Let's get right to the nitty-gritty. I'm going to tell you the definition of white supremacy in less than 60 seconds. White supremacy is the belief that white people constitute a superior race and should therefore dominate society, typically to the exclusion or detriment of other racial and ethnic groups. Now, I'd like to share with you my own commentary here. When you study the origin of race, you'll find out that it was created by Europeans. It was a type of social caste system, if you will. Robin DiAngelo, she's still very much a part of the white supremacist system. She starts off, I am white. And then at the end of that paragraph, she says that she is speaking and addressing to other white progressives like me. This woman still believes in the white supremacist system because she's never forsaken it. Just as I was mentioning that Democrats and liberals tend to think skin color denotes ideology, this is also why I'm considered not one of the good white people, because I don't believe in the system at all. Yes, as of 2020, I started voting once again, even though I kind of think it's pointless, but I've been anti-statist since 2013. So people's attempts to size me up and decide what they think I am always fall short because my skin color doesn't denote my ideology. And when so-called white people from the left and right hear my views, none of them like me. I'm usually ostracized or demonized because I don't support white supremacy, and they all do. They just don't realize it. And that's the underlying reason why they fucking hate me so much. And I consider this a huge compliment. Because unlike what Robin DiAngelo is getting ready to tell you, that the problem is actually white people, I will never say that. The problem is white supremacy. Which is why she's advocating for ideas that support things like DEI, which are performative types of liberal actions that cause discrimination against individuals of European descent to grant positions, and yet it's still never addressing the white supremacist system itself. See? All of Robin DiAngelo's long walls of text don't even properly explain white supremacy. I'm going to go back to this paragraph of hers that I just couldn't tolerate reading anymore. You see right here where she starts talking about Charles Mills right there. She says, Charles Mills describes white supremacy as, quote, the unnamed political system that has made the modern world what it is today, end quote. She says, he notes that while white supremacy has shaped Western political thought for hundreds of years, it is rarely named. In this way, white supremacy is rendered invisible while other political systems, socialism, capitalism, fascism, are identified and studied. In fact, much of its power is drawn from its invisibility. The taken-for-granted aspects of white superiority that underwrite all other political and social constructs. White resistance to the term white supremacy prevents us from examining this system. If we can't identify it, we can't interrupt it. Naming white supremacy changes the conversation because it shifts the problem to white people where it belongs. It also points us in the direction of the lifelong work that is uniquely ours, challenging our complicity with an investment in racism. Yes, this work includes all white people, even white progressives. None of us have missed being shaped by the white supremacy embedded in our culture. Current research in implicit bias demonstrates that all people have racial bias, that most of it is unconscious, and that it does manifest in our actions. Because white people control the institutions, our racial bias is embedded and infused across society and works to the advantage of all white people, regardless of intentions, awareness, or self-image. Our task is not to exempt ourselves from the impact of these conditioning forces, but rather to continually seek to identify how these forces shape us and manifest in our specific lives and interrupt those manifestations. Good God. Okay, what she's actually describing here is white privilege. Okay? There's a huge distinction we need to make here. This woman is never really defining what white supremacy is. Have you guys noticed that? Something else I think is really strange about Robin DiAngelo is she likes this quote from Charles Mills. When she says here that he notes that while white supremacy has shaped Western political thought for hundreds of years, it's rarely named. And then she goes on to say down here that, in fact, much of its power is drawn from its invisibility. While this is true, if you don't define what it is, it kind of enables you to just think something is real and that it exists. She's kind of sounding like a faith-based Christian. Let me show you what I mean. Okay, I just opened up the book of Romans from the Christian Bible. We're going to go to Romans chapter 1 from the King James Version, okay? So Paul is writing this. He's an alleged self-appointed apostle. How convenient, isn't it? The man never spent time with Jesus, claimed to have visions, changed his conversion story 3 different times, but no, he is called to be an apostle. You got to look out for this guy. He said everybody even turned away from him. They didn't believe he was sent by God. We're going to talk about how Paul claims people are without excuse. All right. This is why a lot of people think there's no such thing as atheists, because somewhere deep down, deep, deep down in people's convictions, they know that God is real. But it's not just any God. It's the Christian God. It has to be that one. Okay, let's start at verse 14. This is Paul talking, okay? He says, "For I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believes, to the Jew first," how convenient, "and also to the Greek. For therein is the righteousness of God revealed from faith to faith, as it is written, the just shall live by faith." Okay, we're going to live by faith. Paul says, "For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who hold the truth in unrighteousness." Really? Okay, so Paul is telling us that all of us are holding the truth, but some of us are doing it in unrighteousness. Paul says, "Because that which may be known of God is manifest in them, for God hath shown it to them." So he's telling us we all know this stuff about God. It's been made manifest in us, but we're holding the truth in unrighteousness. Paul continues by saying this about God. He says, "For the invisible things of God from the creation of the world are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, even his eternal power and Godhead, so that they are without excuse." What? Oh, yeah. This is the proof of God, you guys. If you're in doubt as to how you can know that God exists, well, Paul is here to tell us. It is God's invisible qualities from the creation of the world that are clearly seen. And we understand this, allegedly. Even his eternal power and Godhead. So we're without excuse. Now, actually, this is because Paul said we live by faith. That's why. See, right here, verse 17. The just shall live by faith. It's a perception issue. If you have faith that something is true, then literally everything you see is going to reinforce that faith. So a person who is theistic in worldview will look outside and will see a bird or a fucking tree and will say, that right there is proof of God. But it's not just proof of any God. It's proof of the God I believe in. Okay. And how is that proof? They don't know. Well, it's because it's so pretty, or it has like really ornate designs. There's no way that could be by accident. Or it has like, it knows how to find food. Like, it's intelligent. So obviously it had a designer, because when you look at the chair in your kitchen, somebody made that. So when you look at the bird, somebody made that. This is like really, really simple type of thinking. It's not proof of anything. Because an individual who is atheistic in worldview will look at the bird, will look at the tree, and say that is a bird and a tree. That is not proof of your God. Because think about it like this. If I'm talking to a Christian, I can say, well, why is that not proof of the Islamic God? Why is that not proof of Zoroastrianism? And they'll have to admit, well, you're right. Okay, but it's proof of a creator. Okay, ask that person, how is it proof of your personal God? And it always goes back to, well, I believe this because the Bible said this. Okay, so God's invisible qualities are proof. Now let's go back to Robin DiAngelo. The intellectual wonder. She told us that white supremacy has invisible qualities. Yet she never named what they are. I mean, we've read quite a bit of the article so far. If you can't get to your point by this time, you do don't have one. You don't have a point. And you notice how she said she doesn't use the term white supremacy the same way that everyone else does. How convenient, because it has a real definition. In this paragraph here, I'm not going to read the whole thing, but look what she's doing here. Right here, start right here. She says, I am talking about the reasons that have led folks to do things differently today. Why we have Black Lives Matter and showing up for racial justice, BLM leads. Why is she talking about these? These are far left progressive Marxist. This is a Marxist group that tries to smush Black people's causes in with other forms of intersectionality. Like, they have the Black Power Fist with like the trans colors and symbols, LGBTQ. They smush everything together. Well, let's just fight for all the marginalized people. And what ends up happening is the legitimate cause of Black Americans is not fought for. See? When it comes to these programs that allegedly help minorities, you see them benefiting like LGBTQ and others, not Black Americans, who are the ones who have systematically experienced continual suppression at a government level. Interesting. So Robin DiAngelo, she is one of those trend followers who likes things because of how they appear. They're performative actions, because this woman actually has white supremacist ideas. Which is why, as much as this woman is rambling, she never actually defines what white supremacy is. Instead, she identifies as a white person and a white progressive at that. She believes in the system. She wants white allies to be pushed into the spotlight because they are a good role model for white people. Everything she's saying and promoting keeps the white power structure the way it is. How convenient indeed. And the reason I can talk about this without a problem is because I've unlearned white supremacy. Something I have continually noticed over the years since I understood what white supremacy is. These people are soaked in racism and white supremacy. And I noticed this very well years ago about white liberals, white Democrats, white progressives. And I spoke about this in a video that isn't on my channel anymore, but this is why it's been so irritating for me when I have shared things I've learned and done the hard work or suffered in my personal life to achieve certain wisdom. Because it never fails. I've had this happen to me multiple times, that there are people who will watch my content, read my articles, and then use my views, take them on as their own, because they can tell I know what I'm talking about. And they do this so they can fulfill objectives in their personal lives, whether it's that they want money from people, or they don't want to lose someone in their lives, or they're just all around stealing content so that they can make better. People do stuff like this. I mean, this is social media, this is the internet, this is what people do. But I paid a price to get to the place in life that I'm at. So when people try and copy me or take on my views, and they do this to fool other people, eventually their folly does become known because this is not their real views. I have never heard a white progressive or a white liberal or a white Democrat who is still not soaking in white supremacist ideas. There's even this progressive feminist lady. I've talked about her before, but I'm not interested in trying to really implement people by their names. But I've talked about her in content before, and I didn't agree with all of her stuff because she is a feminist and I'm not. But she calls herself a progressive. She also speaks about unlearning white supremacy, but she's infused with white guilt. She has so much of it that she actually expects someone who's black or brown to not accept her because of all the terrible things that white people did. See, I'm not that focused on it. I don't care that much. And so you could easily say, well, doesn't that kind of show that you're more racist since you don't care? No. It shows that I'm not trying to be something in order to not be racist. This is actually the difference. I don't have to, because here's the thing, I never had white guilt. And the reason I never had white guilt is because I didn't do shit. I am not in a group of white people. Yes, I realize other people put me in that group. Do I understand if they're going to think I act like all white people? Yeah, I do. Because that happens to me all the time. People see me, they see how I look, they see my musical interest, or the fact that I like American-style horror movies. You can name a bunch of things that cause me to look like a typical American. But when it actually comes to my heart, who I am on the inside, I'm not into white culture. Which is why I don't fit in with white people. Which is why I react completely different than other white people do about almost anything. Which is also why, once white people hear my views, they don't like me. This woman feels like she deserves a pat on the back because she doesn't have white fragility over the term white supremacy. She writes, "So no, we won't stop using the term white supremacy." She says, "It's not on those of us involved in the movement today to change our language for further white comfort. In fact, that is the height of white entitlement. Rather, it is on white people to break out of our comfort zones, realize that things have changed, and initiate our continuing education and skill building. The internet is overflowing with excellent guides on how to do this. The inability or refusal to do so functions as a form of resistance to change and protection of a very limited and problematic worldview. This resistance is not benign. It functions to hold the current racial order in place. No neutral stance exists. We need to move on and move forward because we are calling it what it is, white supremacy. Can't you just hear all the cheers going on in the background? That she's not only giving herself, but that undoubtedly other white progressives are giving her as well? And possibly some black and brown people on the Democrat side who think she's doing a great work. These are the types of white people that I've noticed black Democrats like. I've talked about this before, but black Democrats hate me because I don't cower or submit to them with these performative actions. Well, if you want a performative white person who's drenched in white supremacy to be on your side and to say things that make you feel like they care, hey, go for it. This woman's entire article never defined white supremacy, you guys. Wow. And look how long it is. But that's kind of concerning. And here's why. Look what it says down here in the italics. This article was originally published by the Good Men Project. It has been edited for Yes Magazine. Let's tap on the real thing. This is the original article. These are byproducts of white supremacy, but they're not the actual thing. And the reason Robin DiAngelo can't define the actual thing is because she's still a part of it. This is why you can have black and brown people in government and nothing changes except this very strange form of anti-racist policies that attempt to just simply install more black and brown faces while restricting white faces. The problem is the system. It's not actually white people. Uh-oh. But Robin DiAngelo says the problem is white people. So if you remove white people, if you discriminate against white people so that you can prop up black and brown people, ta-da, you have solved the problem of white supremacy because there's less white people in power. Oh my God. See, this perception that Robin DiAngelo has is the Democrat position. That's what it is. So if there's more black and brown faces, there's somehow less racism. And a lot of white people, what they've ended up doing is putting themselves under movements, even black nationalist movements, that will invariably subjugate these white people at some point in the near future. And these white people who have white guilt, they don't even notice what causes they're taking up. Because if white supremacy is actually wrong, then black supremacy is wrong too. And just because those black people are not in power now doesn't mean that they won't do the exact same thing that white supremacists have done as a form of payback, as a form of racial supremacy. You can't say that black supremacy doesn't exist because they don't have the power, because it starts as an idea. Yes, they don't have it structurally or systematically, but a lot of these black nationalist movements, which if you don't know what they are, it's not Black Lives Matter, by the way. They're not a threat. Some of these Black nationalist movements, they put themselves under white supremacy now. They're trying to get in similar ways that the Muslim Brotherhood does. But what these groups are not realizing is because the system is the problem, it's never going to allow a takeover. And as I said, whatever has happened in places like England or other parts of Europe, the United States was created for a completely different reason. So it's never going to let that happen because people here are armed. The structural system of white supremacy is the system itself. So all of Robin DiAngelo's little progressive, performative actions and the long wall of word salad and just dodging the actual definition is because that woman actually is a racist. It's very clear from her writings. She feels like a do-gooder. She has this idea that if she shows discrimination against her own people, she can somehow evade the consequences of what the system of white supremacy has done to Black and brown people. See, you should worry about me if I said white people are the problem, because no, we're raised up under this system just like Black and brown people are. We don't always realize it. But if all you're going to do is rant about its invisible qualities and never really define it and only talk about aspects of white privilege or say that the opinion white people have of ourselves affects other people across the globe, you're never really addressing the actual underlying issue, because women like Robin DiAngelo benefit from the system, and that's what she really doesn't want to give up. I'm going to share with you what I think is going to happen with the United States and how it's going to eventually change into something else. As the older generations pass on, the younger generations are going to naturally create a different culture and atmosphere in the United States. This is something I think the older folks are aware of. They've tried to shame and mock the younger generation to prevent them from being better than they already are. And the United States will change, and I think Gen Z is going to lead the way. And that might sound hilarious to a lot of people, because those of you who specialize in mockery to try and suppress people, this is also a byproduct of white supremacy, by the way. And this is all Robin DiAngelo was capable of addressing. As I mentioned, we're byproducts of the system of white supremacy. She just wants to deal with the branches so that she can keep living in the root. Because let's just be real here. This woman is already very privileged. So even if she steps aside so that Black or brown people can be in positions of power, it's not going to affect her at all. She's not making any sacrifices by yapping. In fact, she's just really wasting her time.
Talk to me about when you first realized you were white and whiteness. Yeah, talk to me about that.
It was a very abstract sense. I honestly believe I was about 34 years old. I was college educated. I was a parent. And someone handed me Peggy McIntosh's article.
Yep.
And I read through that list and I had an out of body experience. I could tell you where I was sitting. I'm not ever going to forget that moment where all of a sudden I was like, oh my God, I'm white.
Yep. Yep.
I felt so loudly white that I remember being hesitant to go outside. I didn't want to go outside because everybody could see that I was white.